May I now invite the chairperson, Mr. Keshav Chandra, former member Railway Board, former Railway Board member and ex-officio secretary to the Government of India. May I also request the co-chairperson, Mr. Rajkumar, IDSE, Director, Chief Engineer, Delhi Zone, to please come on the dais. I would also invite the speakers of first technical session, Shri Ashish Rakheja, Managing Director, AEON Consultants, to please come on the dais. I now request Mr. Arul Das, IDSE, President, IDSE Officers Association, to please come on the dais. Mr. Arul Das, I would also request Mr. Guru Vittal, Chief Scientist, CRRI, to please come on the dais.
Sustainable development is exactly what it is, development that meets the needs of the present generation without compromising the ability of future generations to meet theirs. So we'll have an action plan here today, we'll have a roadmap, and basically sustainable development approaches everything in the world as being connected through space, time and quality of life. And with me today here on the dais, we have Mr. Ashish Rakheja, who's going to be speaking on net zero energy buildings in India, learning from the past to design the buildings for the future. Then we have Mr. Arul Das, who's himself an IDSE officer. He's going to be talking on energy resources and MES. And then we have Mr. Guru Vittal, who's the chief scientist with the CRRI. He's taken up a very special subject, the construction of the Indo-Pak border roads. So we start the day with this, and I'll request Mr. Rakheja to be the first speaker. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. My request would be if I could be given my 15 minutes, which were promised to me. So starting the day. I'm really glad to see the first, if you see the technical seminar, the sustainable development appears right as a very prominent name out there. What I'm going to present on is our rich learning that we have. I come from a company called E.ON, and if you look at the word E.ON itself, it means kalpa. It comes out of the word kalpa, which is a Sanskrit word, which is the time period between creation and recreation of the universe. Now, how do I link it here? The way I link it is, if you look at the construction industry today, we have done a lot of errors in the recent past. If you look at the past, we had done the buildings the right manner. But somewhere we started going wrong. The buildings that we have done today are not exactly the way we would like to see. They don't embody or they do not reflect the climate, really. You could be in any part of India, any part of the world, the building starts looking the same, which does not represent the right construction mechanism. So I believe that the construction industry stands at a place where it needs to be recreated, and that's how the word E.ON comes in. Where does the construction industry in India goes today? If you look at it, the India that we have right now, we have about 25 billion square feet of constructed space. Three times more of this constructed space is about to come in next 25 to 30 years' time. So there's three times or more India which is yet to be built, going to be built, and there's plenty of opportunity lies for us in terms of doing it right. What I believe is we need to go back to our roots. India is God's own country. We are a blessed country in many ways. We have a rich inheritance. We are part of the Indus Valley civilization, which is one of the oldest civilizations on the earth. We respect everything, be it water, be it sun, a lot of us worship sun, be it plants are part of our lives, be it gods, be it animals, everything is respected out here in this country. We firmly believe that everything in this universe comes out of five elements, sky, water, fire, earth and air. And that's what is our rich heritage is all about. If you look at in the traditional buildings that we have done, the heritage is very clearly there. If you go by the climatic zones of India, which the National Building Code of India classifies it, there are five climatic zones, hot and dry, warm, humid, composite, temperate, and cold. And the earlier buildings very well reflected this kind of construction technology. You see the construction, the type of buildings, they're very different in different zones. If you go to the cold climates, the kind of buildings are completely different than what you see in the hot and dry climates. But today, of course, is a world of globalization. We travel across the world. Our aspirations are something similar to what the Western countries are doing, right or wrong. That's another area of debate. But definitely, we'd like to see something similar out here. Also, there are aspirations of the 1.3 billion people that we have, which needs to be met. The lifestyles have changed. If you ask any senior members in our society, they will tell you how the lives were different out there. The consequences of not doing the right construction are very much visible. We all talk of planet change, the global warming, everything is around us. And that is where I believe that we need to recreate how what we have been doing earlier. We need to go back and harmonize with the five elements. The vastu, the science which is there, it's a science, needs to be respected, needs to be understood, and the buildings also have to reflect the same technology. Without going further, I'll go take you into the actual project and walk you through a case study how the buildings are being approached today in the construction industry, potentially being followed, and then show you the consequential energy savings out there. This is a building in North India, without naming the building, without naming where in India it is. It's in North India. The goals that we set for ourselves was, of course, the energy conservation, the water conservation, which is paramount. The very important part of it was the comfortable environment for the people inside. After you're making buildings for the occupants, so comfortable environment for them. And finally, we wanted it to be a unique building out there. So we started looking at the five elements which are there in our philosophy. We look at the sky. And what does sky brings in? It brings in a lot of heat. This is North India, where you get ambient temperatures ranging from 1 degree, which is the peak winters, to 45 degrees, which could be the peak summers. So it's a good, diverse climatic zone. When we looked at what gives us the thermal comfort is where do we feel comfortable. What we found was that if we do not do anything, only 25% of time we can be comfortable. I'm not talking about air conditioning. Of course, you can be 100% of time comfortable. But then that's not the way to go. Just sit in the air-conditioned environment is not something we like to do all the time. What it also showed us, in our kind of climate, we are blessed that if you stand in the shade, you can be comfortable for 40% time in the year. And remaining, there's another, evaporative cooling also plays an important role. So if you take a combination of all the natural elements which are there, we can be comfortable for about 75% time in the year. Now, if I show you here, this is some way how we approach the project. This is the solar radiation coming on the building surfaces. What you see, a scale out here, the yellow represents the maximum solar radiation, which is the heat, and the blue represents the least. Of course, you like to be somewhere in middle. Here, we are able to identify the surfaces which are not so good for us. The ones which are yellow needs to be taken care of, even in terms of orienting the building. Now here, what you'll see in this graph is that we are rotating the building every 45 degrees, and this one represents the least energy consumption, and this orientation represents the highest energy consumption. So obviously, just by rotating the building in a right manner, we are able to save 3.5% energy savings in a year itself. Now it's a big number, which is the number I'll come to at the end of this case study. Then we started looking at insulation in the wall. Moment you look at the insulation, this graph tells us as you increase the amount of insulation, it is not necessary that the energy bill of the building will keep on falling down. There is an optimum point beyond which there is no benefit that you get. So we selected the right insulation on the wall as well as the roof. Then we started looking at the shading. If you've been to India Habitat Center in the central zone, you would have noticed there's a very nice cover. You're always comfortable in that zone. So what you see out here is, this is the area which we are trying to use. In summers, you will notice that around afternoon time, the shade will walk in. And then this area will stay shaded till evening. And mind it, I can be very comfortable in the shade. Same area in winter, if I run this video, what you will notice out there is, the same area throughout the daytime will have sun inside, because you need sun in the daytime. So with the same kind of shading devices, it is possible to get a different performance, sun in winters and shade in summers. Started looking at the second element, which is fire. and fire is the sun coming inside, the heat energy coming inside the building. Here we are playing with the amount of glass on the facade. What is the right amount of glass? So we're playing with 80% facade area's glass, 70%, 60%, 50%, and kept on reducing, and kept on seeing what is right for us. And obviously we came to about 50% glass area represented as the right amount of glass to be used. And mind it, we are linking it with the energy bill in the building. We started playing with the height of the windows, how tall the building should be. Sir, I've just spent 5 minutes.
There's
already
been
700. Okay, sorry about
please
that. Carry on. Okay. So this is the height of the building, height of the windows itself. So we started playing with the height of the windows. We started looking at amount of lighting which is coming in, and what we found was that we are able to get about 100% of the areas to be daylit. Even the interior layouts we are able to do, looking at the simulations, that what is the area which is getting the right amount of daylighting inside. So that started adding to our savings. And then going on to the air, this is where we are facilitating the wind to move to the site. We are helping reorganize the blocks which are there in the master plan. What you see here, we are helping them reorganize. And at the end of the day, what you will see is very rightly, with the wind flowing through the entire site. What you see here is the scale on which how the wind is blowing. This dark blue represents 0 meter per second, and light blue represents a good wind velocity. So if you see here what we started, everything was dark blue, if you see in between the buildings, and when we finished in terms of moving the buildings around, in terms of chamfering the building so that there is a right wind flow, at the end of the day, what we got was, I'll leave the video out for the time being, what we got at the end of the day, you will see everything is practically light blue in color. That means the wind is now sweeping the site and it's very well shaded. So if you stand in the shade, you stand in the wind, 75% of the time you're going to be comfortable. Started looking at the solar radiation. This is the solar radiation scale, and identified the areas where the vegetation needs to be done. That means that even the landscape is being done in a strategic manner where it is required. And finally, at the end of the day, I'll show the thing to you. In terms of water, we even did the water conservation. We created ponds from where the hot air was able to blow over it, because what I had also said was the evaporative cooling can help for 11% of time in the year. It's not necessary that we use evaporative desert coolers. So what we did was we had the water pond. The hot air blew over the water pond, got cooled down, and started sweeping the site, which we were able to take inside the building itself. Finally, using Earth's energy, because the Earth's temperature 4 meter below ground is constant round the year, we were able to reject the heat into the ground itself by using the Earth air tunnels. And finally, what we got at the end of the day, what I showed you, very fundamental, where I have not spent even a single money, not even a rupee that I have spent so far. I've only aligned the building with the natural forces. I was able to bring down the energy consumption by 42% in the building itself. So it's all about going back to the roots, going and connecting with the building. When we did this analysis of the building, that what could be done in terms of now putting the mechanical devices in, we started with 7,000 tons of air conditioning. This was about 30 lakh square feet of area. We ultimately ended up installing only about 4,000 tons of air conditioning, which is 45% reduction in the air conditioning energy itself. The energy demand came down from 16 megawatt to 11 megawatt. And that was a big number, not by doing anything, just by getting the right forces. And of course, the renewables could be easily be put, and we can start moving towards what we call a building which is run by the solar power panels itself. So this is what we achieved at the end of the day. Air conditioning reduced by 33%, energy savings came down by 40%, 4 gigawatt hours of renewable energy generation, and 100% wastewater treatment, and 100% of the building was daylit, with everything, with no artificial lighting required inside. The building automatically went on to a platinum zone. There's an Indian Green Building Council. There is a TERI, which gives you the 5-star rating or a platinum rating. The building featured right at the top of it, which proved that the way to go forward is the passive design, and that's where it is. Just to sum it, the Indian Green Building Movement, which is happening at this point of time, started in 2001. They have the rating systems for every kind of building. Latest statistics which have been released says that 3 billion square feet of constructed space today has gone green. So if that's what is going green, I think we must be going the right manner. And these are the features they look at it. And if you look at the elements, each one of those elements are again the same: sun, earth, fire, water, and that's what sky, that's what we are talking about. It's all about the same thing. So if we got 3 billion square feet, I think we must be doing it right. But if I look at what the construction industry today in India is and where the green buildings stand today, that's a small blue dot which you see at the bottom. There's so much more to be done, and so much more can only be done if we are doing it the right way. Finally, I'll end it with my presentation with what the net zero energy buildings are. The concept today is moving that we do not need any city power at all. We should be able to reduce our energy consumption down to so little that you should be able to match it with the solar energy which can be generated within the building. And the classic example would be the Government of India's own building, which is the Ministry of Environment and Forest building at Jorbagh. It's a 300,000 square feet building called Indira Paryavaran Bhavan with a 1 megawatt of solar power panels on the roof, generating its own electricity, does not require any city power connection at all. So I'll just end there. That's all from my side. And that's the future that we need to go. It's not necessary that we put the most expensive technology. It's not necessary that we put most expensive amount of money that needs to go into the buildings. All we need to do is follow the fundamentals and you'll get the building right. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Ashish Rakheja, for a brilliant presentation. Very innovative and very incisive.